Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee for 2024. The first item on the agenda this morning is one for colleagues, which is to agree to take business in private. That is in relation to items 5 and 6, one being consideration of the evidence we are about to hear this morning from the Cabinet Secretary and others, and then in relation to whistleblowers, and the other is in consideration of our work programme. Are members content to take those items in private? We are. That brings us to agenda item 2, which is our inquiry into the A9 duelling project, which follows on from the evidence we heard last week at the last meeting from the Civil Engineering and Contractors Association, as well as current and former senior leaders at Transport Scotland, one of whom I see has a season ticket for our business and has hastened back to tell us something different. I hope this time not the same. However, in that respect, I'm delighted to welcome the Cabinet Secretary this morning, Marie McCallan, MSP, for Net Zero and Just Transport, Net Zero and Just Transition. And from Transport Scotland, we've got Lauren Shackman, Director of Major Projects, and Joe Blewett, who is Head of Sustainable Transport Projects and former A9 Programme Manager for the Development and Statutory Processes, and Rob Galbraith, Head of Project Delivery. We've also received this morning apologies from Edward Mountain, MSP, who joins this committee as a reporter from his own committee, but has other committee business this morning and is unable to be with us. So welcome to you all. I'm going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to say a few words just in a moment, but can I say I've been looking at the way this inquiry has been going, and I think it would be helpful if we had our questions in two phases. One is how did we get here, one is where are we going now. Last meeting, I think Mr. Galbraith will remember, we kind of seem to dot between the two a bit. Our focus is very much on where are we going now. So I would want the earlier part to be quite brief and to the point, but just to clarify on the basis of things we've heard and to see if we can tie down in our own minds where we got to before. And so members will be invited to come in on a random way as they see fit. I'm not one of these people who's allocated everything in advance, so I'm waiting to be inspired by colleagues with the questions that they will ask. Cabinet Secretary, you gave us a very comprehensive advance statement this morning, which I'm very confident you're not going to repeat in full just now, when I invite you to make a few opening remarks, but please do.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting me along to this inquiry. As you've noted, the committee has already received a written submission, and you've also heard my statement to the Parliament, which I delivered just prior to Christmas recess, and that was very much what you were talking about there, that forward look to completion of the A9. You've also taken a considerable amount of written evidence from ministers and from current and former chief executives of Transport Scotland, along with a range of stakeholders. Now, given the extent of first-hand evidence collected around historic events, I anticipate that I will add most value today by doing just as you suggested in respect of looking forward. However, to the extent that I am able, I absolutely want to be able to assist the committee with their retrospective look as well. As I noted in my submission, I have considered all the previous written statements, and I've taken advice from my officials on that period leading up to my appointment last year. But I hope you'll appreciate my reflections will be just that. They are not first-hand experience. Despite that, I'm very pleased to now have published the refreshed delivery plan for the A9, which has been delivered, as I said, in December to foreground certainty of delivery, but to very carefully balance that against the need to minimise disruption, to take account of market capacity, and indeed to work within the financial constraints that we face. And final comments I would make is in respect of the criticality of safety, and how important that has been for me. And I want to put on the record my heartfelt sympathies to everybody who has either lost a loved one on the A9 or indeed who has been injured in an accident, because that's been pointed out to me to be of great importance. Duelling as far as I'm concerned, is the key safety mechanism. But we can't wait for duelling, and interim safety measures are being pursued as well. But I shall conclude there. I'd very much welcome this opportunity to restate the government's commitment to the A9, to look back insofar as I'm able to from my own experience. I very much understand your interest in this, and of course by the nature of this committee, being the public petitions, the public's as well, so I will look forward to some questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, I don't want to lose sight of the fact that we are advancing the interests of a petitioner and a petition. And the ambition of that petition is that we have the A9 completed and that consideration is given to a national memorial. And obviously your statement to Parliament means that there is now a programme identified that will ultimately deliver on the aims of the petition, which is why I think we want to talk about, you know, how that is going to be achieved and whether or not there are risks associated with that in the current marketplace. But looking back, I'm obviously in the committee, are obviously grateful, probably less grateful than we expected, given it all arrived just before Christmas, but to the voluminous response to our requests for information, which we received. It was about a foot thick by the end of the day. And I don't know, I mean, are you aware of all the stuff that we received, Cabinet Secretary? I mean, have you been briefed as opposed to having read through all this yourself, can I ask, just in terms of the past experience?
So I think, if I remember correctly, the convener, there were some upwards of 80 papers sent to the committee. I have read a selection of them, and I have read summaries of a selection of them, and I've read the written statements from previous ministers.
And well, and this is a question I put to Mr. Galbraith last week, who will no doubt be wanting to reassure me in the same soporific tones with which he sought to do last time. But I came to this it's not an issue with which I have been directly involved. It's not, you know, I mean, as the member for Eastwood, it's not the first thing that is of concern to my constituents. So I don't, as some do, have a particular field of expertise. So I read through the narrative, and it is just this point that I tried to explain to Mr. Galbraith. There is a consistency of commitment and policy objective to the delivery of the A9 by a date, both privately and publicly, of 2025, from the moment the project is announced, even though it's accepted there are challenges associated with that commitment, until somewhere around 2018, when, reading the papers, a vagueness came in, and I've never been able to quite understand what the genesis of that was. It's not clear to me whether those involved in the delivery of the project think something isn't going to happen now and we need to think about different ways, funding streams, operational ways to deliver it, none of which is shared with the public. This is all happening internally. Or whether ministers have led this going forward. Graham Barn last week said that he thought it became unachievable because the political will to provide the required funding to do the job was just not there when it was required. So I really want to try and understand, given that it was much, much later before Parliament and the public became aware that we weren't achieving that target, what was it? How did the realisation that the challenges that had been identified might mean that there was going to be a delay became apparent to ministers, and who was then trying to drive matters forward in terms of, do we need to look at different ways to do it? Was it from the top down or the bottom up?
Thank you, Convener. I think it's a very fair observation, and I'll seek to answer all of your points in that, but do come back to me if I miss any of them. I think I would start by saying there was always an understanding that this was a complex project. In fact, during my statement in Parliament, I said, you know, the A9 is a complex project. It's 11 complex projects. And I think that is evident right from the early papers which Alex Neil received. Complex as to the statutory processes that have to be gone through, the design, the procurement approach, and then, of course, funding. Now, you mentioned 2017-18 as being a point at which, in your view, 2025 was accepted as not being doable. For the record, I would refute that, and I would say that it wasn't until late 22 that it was finally advised to ministers that there was no practical route to completion by 2025. Now, I absolutely accept, as time goes on, there is a diminishing likelihood of completion by 2025. That's absolutely plain, because it requires ever more capital up front and ever more disruption on the route in order to complete it. But in 2017, I think the advice that you are thinking about and referring to was advice that ministers received on moving to a new private finance model, and advice that that would take so much time to develop in and of itself that we would be pushing beyond 2025. There was always an understanding that that entirely capital-funded approach with increasing levels of disruption remained possible, albeit, I accept, with a diminishing likelihood. If I could identify... Yeah, of course.
On that point, that's the one I don't quite understand. Was it officials who thought this is financially not going to happen, we need to float the idea of a different funding model, and that that may then lead to delays, and that was communicated up? Or were ministers saying to officials, have we got the funding for this? And if not, do we need to look to a different funding model? It's not clear from the papers to me which way round this discussion began.
Well, it's a combination. Ministers rely on advice from officials on the appropriateness of a certain path forward and options available to us. Ministers, it's then for Cabinet to agree that funding should be brought forward for whatever that is. But if I could identify one key issue that I think pertains very closely to what you are asking, that would be the reclassification in 2014 of the not-for-profit distribution model, that private financing model. That was an ONS decision in 2014, which meant that I think the financing model that we had previously considered would form part of the funding package was no longer available to us. And it wasn't until 2019 when the Scottish Futures Trust advised that the mutual investment model was a suitable replacement, that we had that private financing option open to us. So officials would advise us of that. They did a huge amount of work then to prepare for a MIM. But that original private financing approach coming out of the realm of possibility in 2014, I think did have an impact on the timetable. And I would set that alongside a slight delay in statutory processes as the two reasons that I believe the project has been delayed.
OK. Fergus Ewing?
Yes, good morning, Cabinet Secretary and witnesses. Alex Neil, in his evidence, said that he believed that there was more than sufficient capital to deliver the project. And he also set out in his evidence a detailed statement about when each of the sections of the A9 was to be duelled. Why wasn't that adhered to? Because right from the start, it was breached.
Well, again, I'm straying slightly into the territory of interpreting what Alex Neil thought. I think that we have to remember that his comments, quite understandably, are within the four corners of the time that he was involved with this. That was very early in the development of it. I think the advice that he received was, yes, Minister, this is how we are taking it forward, this is how we propose to do it. But it was also quite heavily caveated by there are a great many things to be worked out here. And I think, actually, some of the other ministers' comments on this, including Nicola Sturgeon's, are helpful, hopefully, to the committee, because I think that she's pointing out that Mr. Neil was absolutely correct to say that for his purposes at that time, funding had been identified. But I think what Ms. Sturgeon's view of that was that, well, that was for a 1 to 2 year period during a long project, and that's not uncommon for major projects. Very seldom at the very beginning of such a complex project will you have certainty over delivery and funding right through to the end. But that's what it was. It was Mr. Neil's impression of that 1 to 2 year period rather than the whole thing.
Well, I hear what you say, Cabinet Secretary, but I'm just not convinced, because there was a complete failure to adhere to the very clear schedule of works and programming, because it set out in which year every section would be done. And that's completely abandoned.
I don't deny that there was delays, Mr Ewing. I think what I would say is the principal reason for that were the two things I pointed out to the convener. Firstly, the ONS reclassification of the not-for-profit distribution model in 2014, and a 1 to 2 year delay on statutory processes.
Well, I was interested in the emphasis that, Cabinet Secretary, you've given to the ONS decision. I don't recall there being any ministerial statement about that at the time. Why not?
I couldn't say for certain what the parliamentary choreography was around that, Mr Ewing. I'm afraid I wasn't there, nor, frankly, am I in a position to say why or why not that wasn't done.
I appreciate, Cabinet Secretary, that you weren't responsible. I was part of the government for a while, so I had a collective responsibility. I've never sought to shrug away from that, but I never had portfolio responsibility. But, I mean, why did it take, then, 5 years from the ONS, the critical watershed decision of the ONS, where apparently there was no statement made to Parliament about how significant this was, even though you now say this was the absolute critical moment in your view. Why did it then take till 2019 for there to be a plan about private finance? Because that's 5 years during which most of the work was supposed to have been done, or a very substantial proportion, according to Alex Neil's plan.
So two sides to that question, and I'll try and take them both. And actually, I might briefly pass to officials just to explain some of the work that was done on developing an alternative private financing model, because you're right, 5 years is a long time. And I know that, you know, as I said, Scottish Futures Trust were involved. MIM is something that was developed by the Welsh Government, and it's been adapted for use in Scotland. But I should say that I don't just identify that as the key issue. I do also see that there were delays in statutory processes, although I'm happy to come on to why I think actually that may have saved us some time in the end by having only one public inquiry, albeit I should prefer that they had been quicker. But the point that I wanted to make, the new point I want to make, is that there wasn't a vacuum of work during that time. Work was progressing. The statutory processes work was progressing to the point where we now have 92% ministerial decisions in hand for those. We brought forward work on the Kincraig to Dalradie route, which was completed in 2017, and the additional section of Lincarty to the Pass of Burnham began in 2019, completed in 2021. And of course, all that work was ongoing in the background to develop a new private finance model. But I don't know whether any of the team want to say something about that five-year period and maybe why it takes so long for Robert, Joe, maybe?
I can maybe add a little bit to the detail of the work that was going on in that period. I'm afraid that that's work that was taken forward with Scottish Futures Trust rather than Transport Scotland, because it's looking at a replacement for NPD as a private finance style of contract suitable for use across sectors. It's not sector-specific to roads or accommodation or anything. So that's why SFT would be tasked with that piece of work, and they were responsible for taking it forward. And it was only in 2019, when ministers endorsed SFT's recommendations, that there was a new replacement for the non-profit distributing model available for Transport Scotland to begin considering as a potential vehicle for its contracting approach.
Were SFT given a deadline when they were commissioned, and did they adhere to that deadline, and when did they put forward the recommendations?
You would have to direct those questions to SFT. I'm afraid it's not something I think we need to
get at this, because there was 5 years
where
all this work was supposed to have gone on, and really we've only seen two of the sections. I mean, these are welcome, of course, but there's a complete absence of an explanation, Cabinet Secretary, about what went wrong. Can I just ask one final question?
Mr. Cabinet, I think he was halfway through his response, Mr. Ewing. So I think
was he? Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah,
I'll allow him to finish.
One point I was keen to finish. The bulk of the work, in actual fact, was actually planned to take place 2019 to 2025 under the original plan. So it wouldn't have been in progress by 2019. Most of it would only just have been starting.
Well, it didn't go ahead then either, did it? Has there been any review into the failure to adhere to the plan? Has there been any internal review by the Scottish Government or anybody else for that matter as to why the timetable slipped and why there has been a failure to implement the very clear pledges that were made by the Scottish National Party repeatedly to the electorate at every election?
Well, in terms of formal reviews, that hasn't been done within government, but I am very clear, and I hope I've set out clearly today what my view, and it's shared by my officials, is for the two principal causes of delay. This inquiry will add to that work as well. I have to say my focus since becoming the Cabinet Secretary in 23 has been on getting this optimum delivery plan sorted, moving to that NEC for contract as amended, and progressing interim safety measures in the meantime. But formal review inside government, no. I think we have quite a well-established view of what the two principal causes in our view are for delay.
Did Transport Scotland not done a review of any sort? None whatsoever, despite the fact that this was the flagship pledge and it's completely slipped. No review at all. Is that right, Mr. Shine?
Well, there is review all the time.
Yeah,
there?
I mean, the fundamental thing here between looking at the procurement options and considering MIM against design and build is to make sure that we get value for money right across the public purse, and also to make sure that there are opportunities for different sorts of contractors across the industry. So using capital money or revenue finance is a fine balancing act, and it wasn't a particularly quick thing to resolve. So a number of years, I wasn't there, I wasn't part of the process at that time, but I can assume that a lot of thought was given to, can we use revenue financing or should we be using capital financing, and what were the budgets like at that particular time? What was the best balance for the public purse, bearing in mind the considerable cost of the duelling programme?
Well, I understand all that, but with respect, Mr. Shankman, that wasn't what I asked. I asked whether there was any review of any sort into the failure to deliver on our pledges in government. I mean, was there any review or not?
With all respect, Mr. Ewing, I think I have answered that question. I said there hasn't been a formal internal review, but we review on an ongoing basis the reasons for delay as we think they are, as they emerge, and I've identified the two key ones that we attribute.
I
can take, Mr. Ewing, you might not be happy with the answer, but I think we have an answer. There was one. I'm going to come to Mr. Gold, but there was just something arose there that left me slightly confused. Prior to the change of rules in 2014... were the government relying on a private finance contribution to this project? I mean, I understood it was a fully capital-funded project at that point.
Again, I might bring my officials in and they will ensure I'm accurate on this, but I think it would be fair to say there was always an expectation that it would be a combination of capital and private financing to the project. And indeed, the Scottish Public Finance Manual requires the government to consider private financing for projects. And of course, the not-for-profit distribution model had been used in a number of major projects that the government had taken forward. So that 2014 date and it being reclassified was quite a turning point, I would say.
OK, I'm happy to leave it at that and turn to Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Convener. Just to follow up initially on Mr. Ewing's the line of questioning. Transport Scotland officials have told the committee that it only became clear in late 2022 that the 25 completion date would be missed. But the committee has heard that it was common knowledge amongst experts that the date would be missed several years before that. And I'd like to ask the Cabinet Secretary if she is concerned about the apparent discrepancy between the views of officials and external engineering experts.
Thank you for the question. So without pointing to the experts that you're referring to, I'll take the question in the generality. I mean, what I would say is that ministers welcome the advice that we rely on from our officials, and I have always been very satisfied with the advice and support that I've gotten from Transport Scotland. But equally, that is always better when it's complemented with views from people in industry or working on these matters on the ground. So from my perspective, we take advice and information in the round. I think that I've mentioned before that there was always an understanding that an all-capital, increasingly disruptive approach could be taken until late 2022, when that was no longer a possibility. But all the while, we were doing work to consider a better combination of actions. Industry's view, I think some would accept, that there was an opportunity to do it very quickly, very disruptively. I think Graham Barnes, when he was in front of the committee, did mention how quickly he thought it could be done. I think he talked about, you know, Inverness potentially being cut off and nobody would want that. But, you know, physically it still could be done. And that's what I mean about a diminishing likelihood. So there are different views. Ministers take them all on board, but I wouldn't want to diminish the quality of advice that we get from Transport Scotland, which I very much value.
Okay, thanks for that. I wonder if you consider the road order processes used to authorise major road projects to be fit for purpose.
Sorry, Mr Golden, can I just ask to elaborate on that slight... Is this the statutory...
To move it, to stick to what's happened okay. before, and I know Mr Torrance was actually keen to raise that particular
okay.
question.
Right.
Mr Chowdhury, have you got a final question for us in relation to how we got here before we switch to where do we go from here now?
Yeah, I mean, just... Good morning. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just in the question my colleague Morris asked just now... In what point were Scottish ministers first aware of the potential for the completion being missed? You know, the previous question Maurice Golden asked.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll try and clarify this. So late 2022 was the point at which submission came to ministers advising that there was now no possible route through to completion by 2025. That would have been received by Ms Gilruth, Mr Matheson at the time, and Ms Gilruth updated Parliament after the Christmas recess in respect of both that, the timetable, and I think the Tamatin Tamoy procurement problems that we had faced. She did them both at the same time. So late 2022 was the fight, was the advice that came that said, look, 2025 is no longer doable, albeit I recognise there is a diminishing likelihood of it in the months leading up to that. And I think that would have been reflected in advice as well.
Okay. I just had one more question. If I may.
How we got here.
Correct, yes.
Yeah.
At the previous session, Transport Scotland advised the committee that they were 92% through with the statutory process back in 2011. I mean, when the original timetable for the project was set out, estimate time to complete the statutory process was 6 years. We're now double the time. Just want to know what engagement did the ministers took with the Transport Scotland during that time?
So I think that, you know, that identifies a really key point as far as I'm concerned, which is, as I said at the beginning, Convener, that the statutory process is taking a little longer than had initially been anticipated when planning is certainly, in my view, one of the reasons for the delay. But I would caveat that by saying, again, this is a project of great complexity. I think that when Roy Brannan was in front of you, he discussed the number of special scientific interest areas, the national park, all of these things that make it a complex project. And whilst statutory processes did take too long, in my view, they're a very important part of democratising infrastructure development and the engagement with the public. And actually, we've been... Well, I was going to say lucky in the sense that we've only had one public inquiry, but I wouldn't put it down to luck. I would put it down to the quite robust and deep engagement that was had with communities. Now, that may have meant that it took a bit longer, but we may also have saved time by having fewer public inquiries. I don't know. All I'm saying is that I think that deep engagement is the right approach.
OK, thank you. Well, let's switch to where do we go from and how do we manage things going forward. David Torrance.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to other witnesses. Cabinet Secretary, can you outline the current governance structure for A9 dualling programme and what is your role in that, Cabinet Secretary?
Yes, absolutely. So I'll maybe speak to my role and my view of officials, and then if they've got anything to add, they can do so. Probably worth pointing out that since Ms Hislop and I took over the running of the transport brief, there's been a slightly different approach taken to that which has been taken before. Previously, the Minister for Transport took direct responsibility for the bulk of the portfolio responsibility as it stood, and the Cabinet Secretary had an oversight role. We have taken a slightly different approach, whereby I now have explicit responsibility for parts of it, and it's a ever so slightly slimmer junior ministerial role. I think this is working well. I think it provides better connection between the Minister and Cabinet, and also it helps relieve a little bit of pressure on the junior minister because it's a significant role. So her and I work together on this. The explicit responsibilities are that I have responsibility for major infrastructure, major projects investment, and her for major projects delivery. And those two things together means that we will both work on the A9, have done to date and will do going forward. In terms of governance structures, we will regularly meet with Director of Major Projects and his team to receive updates on our priorities in respect of the A9, and I should say in a range of other major projects, rest and be thankful, others. And I also meet twice weekly with directors from Transport Scotland for operational updates on matters. But there's a very regular rhythm of advice received. And between ministers, Ms Hislop and I very much share the responsibility. And of course, I report into Cabinet, and the Deputy First Minister has a role in all of this as well, owing to her finance responsibilities. But I don't know, would you be interested to know the internal officials' governance?
Yeah, so we have a programme board for the A9, which meets typically every 6 weeks or so. And there are four directors on that board, and including the Chief Executive Officer of Transport Scotland. And we discuss the whole programme. Individual projects have their own individual project meetings, as you might expect. So Tamatin De Moy will have its own particular monthly meeting as it progresses forward, and all the other projects as well. And the idea is that each of the projects come together, report into the programme board on a regular basis, and we'll continue to review the frequency of the meetings, the attendance at that board, and how it reports back out to the CABSEC and the Minister for Transport, how it addresses engagement across the corridor with stakeholders, the members of the public, the risk profiles, and all the things you'd expect from a programme board of a project of that scale.
Cabinet Secretary, my colleague touched on it earlier. Do you consider a road order process used to authorise major road projects to be fit for purpose? And if not, do you have any plans to update this process?
I'm just going to apologise to the committee. When Mr Golden asked that question before, I just wanted to clarify that he meant the statutory processes. I know that Mr Barnes had spoken about his view that had slowed down the process. I would say, first of all, that I understand that view from Mr Barnes' perspective. His objective is to get projects moving and moving well, and I appreciate his perspective in all of that. Again, I think I would come back to the point about statutory processes are laborious, there is no doubt about it, but actually they're a really important part, as we all know from representing our constituents and their interests when major infrastructure is happening on their doorstep, to ensure that the right processes are gone through, that consultation happens thoroughly, and that people are really engaged in the development of it. And that pertains to roads just as it does to a whole suite of infrastructure projects, not least energy, which is something that is being grappled with just now and will increasingly be so as we seek to upgrade the grid. So I have been clear that I think the statutory processes took a little longer in the case of the A9 than we had been expecting. I think they're a very important part of democratising infrastructure development. And I wouldn't like to suggest that there would be any shortcuts around it. And I reflect again that, you know, to date, we've only had one public inquiry in what is a majorly complex project, which I think is a success in some ways of the deep engagement that was had. But I don't know if there are any technical reviews.
I could comment that I know that there's a review of the statutory process just starting underway. We have a representative within our major projects directorate taking part in that review. I think it's in its early stages, but there is moves to look at the process and see how it can be refined or improved moving forward.
Can you explain why a hybrid approach to A9 dualling has been adopted, and how does the total cost compare to a capital funded approach?
Okay, I'm definitely going to come to Rob on some of the close detail on costs, because it's very easy for me to use the wrong figures when I don't have them in front of me. I would say, why was a hybrid approach adopted? Well, I think I mentioned earlier that I think it was always expected that a combination of funding techniques, if I can use that horribly untechnical term, would be adopted, because that allows the government to best use the resources that it has to achieve its objectives. It recognises that capital can be in short supply. Increasingly, that has been so. All members who've been in front of, who've had cabinet secretaries in front of them on the budget, will have heard us talking ad nauseam about the restraints and the constraints on capital budgets that are increasingly being felt. So I think the hybrid allowed us both financially to spread the burden between the capital budget and the revenue budget of the government. I think that the size and scale of the A9 also lends itself to a combination because, well, for example, in the plan we've set out, we can make progress on a capital basis with the first three southern sections, and then the northern and the remaining sections suit well being bundled into MIM baskets. In terms of cost, I am going to hand over to Rob for some of the detail, but I'll be absolutely upfront that capital is, in the long run, the less expensive way of completing major projects, but capital is not as readily available as a combination of capital and revenue.
Just to pick up a bit more detail on cost, so we look at cost in two ways when we're making comparison between procurement options. So one way that we compare is the cash that will be spent over time. So that's what we call an outturn cost. And within that, we're looking at what the effects of future inflation would be expected to be. And that's a useful thing to look at, but it's not and shouldn't be, in my view, an ultimate decision maker, because what you've also got to think about is what is the value in present day cost of the decision that you're making when you discount the effects of inflation, because that's a decision in terms of current value of money. So when we talk about current value of money comparison, the difference between a fully MIM option that we were looking at and a capital-based design and build option was around about 14%. The hybrid option, the difference is about 10%, and that's with the hybrid being 10% more costly in an equivalent cash value terms, in an equivalent present value of money terms. Now, when you compare outturn cash figures, the figures are quite different because of the effects of inflation. But that's driven by the timing of when money is spent. When you spend money on a private finance contract, you're spending it for a long period of time into the future, so it attracts more inflation. But that inflation is attaching to lower sums of money than if you have to spend it on capital money outlay in the next few years. And it's that comparison that's really critical to understand and that drives the difference in the cost comparator.
I might just very briefly add to that as well, that I should, just for the committee's awareness, and you may already be aware, but hopefully you'll be comforted to know that the MIM model has managed out some of those worst excesses of private sector profiteering that were apparent in historic PFI deals. The way it works has been designed to not allow for that.
Cabinet Secretary, how confident are you that the programme for June the 9 will come within the £3.7 billion budget? And is there any robustness in these figures that could back it up?
So that the advice that I have is that the total scheme cost estimate, which is a defined way of measuring, is that we will be looking at £3.7 billion. I'm just checking my notes here. So that compares... So when you adjust that for inflation, that's the equivalent of £2.45 billion, which is well within that original estimate of £3 billion at 2008 prices. And I think that goes to what Rob was explaining there about the way that we compare spend. So the advice that I have is that comparing apples with apples in terms of that 2008 estimate, the £3.7 in nowadays spend should be within the original budget. And that gives me some comfort. And I don't want to misquote Mr. Barnes, but I think he was asked about how realistic the funding proposals were. And I will check, because I have his transcript here, but I think he endorsed that it wasn't... I think he said not unrealistic, which I'll take to mean realistic.
Thank you very much. I'll come to you in a second. Just a couple of questions arising from what I've heard. On the £3.7 billion, there is within the pile of documents that we received a kind of funding trail, and at one point figures as high as £6.25 billion are identified in relation to the project. Where is the... Can you explain why you are confident about the £3.7 billion, and is that a wholly incomprehensive figure, or was the allusion to £6.25 billion in papers we received, did that include other considerations which... and have they disappeared, or do they continue to sit alongside the £3.7 billion?
I think this is a perfectly understandable question, which I have asked myself from time to time when I've been reading all of my papers. I think, and I will hand over to Rob just to make sure I'm absolutely correct, but these are different ways of expressing costs. So the £3.7 billion is the total scheme cost estimate. And as I say, we compiled that figure so that it could be directly comparable to that 2008 figure, which was also the total scheme cost estimate. I think the higher numbers, the 4.6 and others, is the outturn cost, which takes account of inflation and other issues that can bear down on costs. But before I put anything on the record which isn't accurate, I'm going to hand over to Rob to try and explain that.
I think we touched on this the last time I was with the committee. So the £3.7 billion is April 2023 prices, so that's essentially a present day price. So it doesn't include forward inflation from this date, and it does not include costs for operation and maintenance of the constructed costs. When you're referring to the 4.6 and the 6.25, that's within papers when we're discussing procurement options for the remaining parts of the programme. So one thing to note is it doesn't include costs that have already been spent, because that's not part of the decision making on future spend that's going to be incurred. And what we're trying to do within those cost estimates is compare if we take a capital funded solution and deliver that versus if we deliver a MIM private finance solution. And to get a like for like comparison, because there's a 30-year operation and maintenance period for the private finance solution, you have to put 30 years of operation and maintenance into the capital funded D&B solution so you can compare on a like for like basis. So it includes operation and maintenance costs that aren't part of a total scheme cost estimate, and it includes future inflation costs which aren't part of an April 23 pricing cost. So the numbers there, they represent outturn, but they represent outturn for a different scope and also not even for the full amount of the programme.
It's important that we have that stated. I'm going to bring in Mr. Ewing now, because obviously quite a large part of our evidence about the future of the programme has not so much been about whether people want to do it, or not even so much about whether the money might be there to do it, but whether in fact there are going to be troops on the ground who can actually deliver it. Mr. Ewing?
Perhaps I can come on to that one moment. Just the first area I wanted to ask was that the outline plan, Cabinet Secretary, for completion of the duelling project of the A9 by 2035 is the envisaged date, is subject to one very important caveat, which kind of raises very serious questions in my mind about whether actually the plan will be delivered, and that is that the use of the mutual investment model contracts is subject to further decision-making in late 2025, based on an updated assessment of expected market conditions. That means that a decision could be taken, Cabinet Secretary, not to use MIM. What criteria will be applied in 25 as to whether or not MIM will be used? And if MIM isn't used, what's the contingency plan?
So thank you for the question. I'll take the last part first. If market conditions in 2025 that prevail at the time are not suitable and mean that we can't go forward with a MIM, we do have contingency that the 2035 date could still be met via capital funding, provided that capital was available. And I don't know what will prevail in 2025, but what I do know is that if I'm in post, I will be determinedly pushing for capital to be available should MIM not prevail. But my preference is that MIM will be available. Now, it is absolutely right that a government creates staging posts for consideration of prevailing market conditions at the time. That is how we discharge our duty of prudent public spending. It would be... It would not be correct for me to make that decision now. The Bank of England has raised interest rates 14 times in the last 2 years. They are at an all-time high. Now is, would be a particularly bad time to enter into borrowing at the cost that it currently is. So we've very deliberately created that opportunity in 2025 to allow us to assess the market conditions, which are, fingers crossed, predicted to improve. We're in a particularly sticky spot just now. But I do have to very robustly defend the government taking that chance to assess the conditions at the time and then make the decision.
I'm not sure they're an all-time high. They're certainly a relative high. But,
thank you, Convener, you're quite
I'm
right.
I'm not so old that I can't remember them being considerably higher than that.
I probably am not old enough to remember.
Just standing back for a moment, I mean, the capital budget available to the Scottish Government each year is of the order of between £4,000 to £5,000 million. Now, I think it's reasonable to assume that that will continue to be the case. So by 2035, that's 10 years, maths suggests that there's a total of £40,000 to £50,000 million available in the capital budget. And the Highlands is wanting 3.7, which is less than 10% of that total. So, I mean, why is the Scottish Government not making a clear, cast-iron commitment that if MIM proves to be too expensive for the reasons, Cabinet Secretary, that you've set out, that there will be a clear guarantee that a sum equivalent to less than one-tenth of the total capital will be available for the Highlands, particularly since, and this is just a matter of fact, there's been hardly any spending on roads projects in the Highlands since devolution. All the money's gone elsewhere. We've had a couple of roundabouts and a couple of small sections of dual carriageway. Surely the government recognise it's the Highlands' turn, and if the government can't make a commitment that if MIM is too expensive, that traditional capital spend will be used, does that not suggest that the Highlands don't even merit a tenth of the total capital spend between now and 2035? A proposition that will simply not go down very well at all in my constituency or the Highlands as a whole.
I think Mr Ewing's advocacy on these points is very effective, and it is absolutely heard loud and clear. I suppose in my perspective, I can't make decisions based on regional competition. I have to make decisions on the basis of what's right, what presents value for money, what's best for the people of Scotland. And I should say that I consider that the dualling of the A9 is one of the most important pursuits in respect of what's right for the people of Scotland. And that's why I've been determinedly trying to work on this optimum delivery plan. Now, in terms of certainty, Cabinet has agreed to my plan. They have understood the point about 2025 and MIM decision making and our view that 2035 remains possible should capital be made available in the case that MIM isn't suitable. They have collectively agreed to manage the financial pressures that that will create, and that delivers a degree of certainty which we haven't had to date. In terms of capital, Mr Ewing's absolutely right to point out the capital budget for the government. I think when Roy Brannan was here, he pointed out that we have about 40% of capital spend, the vast majority of which is within transport. But if I just give you this year's draft settlement as an example of that, firstly, it is being eroded, but that doesn't speak to where we've come from. That's just me speaking about where we're going. And I always have to balance objectives. So right this year I'm planning to invest over £1 billion in roads, which is up 26.2%. That includes a year's worth of progression against the A9 optimum delivery plan. It includes critical work on the A83 Rest and Be Thankful, £47 million to protect the integrity of the M8 Woodside Viaduct, and others. So I appreciate these major projects are not directly applicable to your inquiry, but they do demonstrate how every year there are priorities to balance. But I would end that by saying that A9 dualling is a key priority.
Moving on to a different point raised by Graham Barr in some detail in his evidence, you will see, is this, that, you know, unlike in the past, over the next 10 years, there is an enormous amount of civil engineering work that is planned to be undertaken in Scotland, but in the Highlands in particular. We're looking at £40 billion on grid upgrades. We're looking at £1 billion in Scottish Water, Network Rail 3.5 to electrify the rail network. There's substantial civil engineering work in Haventus, in Invergordon, in renewables aspects. And then there's pump storage contracts, which SSE and others plan. the reason I raise that is that Graham Barn has pointed out that that means that there will be a big choice of work for civil engineers, and arguably some of the other works that I've mentioned may be more profitable than roads contracts, where the profit margins typically have at best been 3%, although that's never been achieved in the last several years, according to the SICA. So you know, what is the government view about this? And is there a real risk that, even if we assume, Cabinet Secretary, that the money is available, that there won't actually be the companies and the people and the expertise to carry it out, because they'll be too busy doing other more profitable work, which we all hope will be able to be done as well?
Yes, absolutely. I noted Mr. Barnes' comments on all of this, and I think all of us would welcome what he set out in respect of that very busy pipeline of work when in Scotland in the next 10 to 20 years. I absolutely welcome it, and the government does as well. I think it speaks firstly to why the upgrade of the A9 is so important, because as well as those safety points that I made at the start, it is that key economic route connecting Scotland. It's an arterial route, it's the spine of Scotland, and it will be absolutely critical to facilitating those economic opportunities that you've spoken to. I think, firstly, that the delivery plan that we've set out now provides a degree of certainty on the direction of travel. I know that from my engagement with industry on this and in other matters, having a clear articulation of the government's direction of travel is one of the most useful things in terms of creating certainty in the market. We have also, I think, the move to the NEC4 contract as amended will be something which is welcomed by industry. I think Mr. Barnes welcomed it, and I hope that its use will do as Mr. Ewing says and make matters attractive and hopefully speedy. And I would finally say that we already have very close engagement with industry, and that will absolutely continue as Mr. Ewing is quite right, the market becomes busier and busier.
Can I just ask one final question? Inverness is 168 miles from Glasgow, where Transport Scotland's big office is located. There's no Transport Scotland in Inverness or the Highlands. Almost all of the capital money will be spent on the A9 and the A96 over the next 10 years. Why is there not a Transport Scotland office based in Inverness? And will there be one? And will staff be relocated there? And is the absence of such a presence not a kind of bit of a sign that there is still not that absolute commitment to delivery of this project? Because your staff have to travel up the road, stay in a hotel, or drive up the road and back. And you know, I've met some of the staff.
I think the question's there is just, I'm conscious of our time as well. Yeah.
I think there's two points I would say. First of all, I think that Transport Scotland and ministerial presence in Inverness, but indeed anywhere where we have major developments, is really important, and I always encourage that. And we have a suite of engagement planned from the start of the new year as we complete the delivery programme. I don't currently have any plans to relocate Transport Scotland's office from Glasgow to Inverness. We will have Transport Scotland officials who live in Inverness and surrounding areas, but you know, I'm not planning to relocate offices. I do think that presence of ministers and staff in the areas in which we're working are vital, and I will continue to encourage that.
Mr. Golden.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, Transport Scotland would be more than welcome in Dundee if you are looking at other locations. Apologies. Cabinet Secretary, you said A9 is a key priority, but clearly meeting climate change targets is also a key priority as well. And my assessment would be that the 2030 net zero target is under severe pressure for Scotland to meet. And indeed, transport sector in terms of emissions reductions is going to be a key priority as well. And I just wonder if the Cabinet Secretary has identified any conflict between the project completion and meeting our climate targets, particularly in the context of 2030.
I think it's a really good point and something which I considered very closely. And I suppose that's one of the things about transport and net zero being in the same portfolio, that you've got the same budget to try and balance between these issues. I think my view with the A9 is that it is a long-standing commitment. It has a safety imperative. It has the opportunity for economic regeneration, but actually it's more than that, it's economic prosperity. And I will always, with my climate and environment responsibilities, seek to find the finest possible balance between those competing interests. And I think that we will need roads in a net zero Scotland. Yes, I hope that they will be driven by low emissions, electric, hydrogen vehicles, but we will need roads, they will need to be safe, and they will help to ensure the economic prosperity of the country.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Just a final question. You mentioned economic regeneration, and we've quite rightly focused on the actual road, but I wonder if the relevant road infrastructure will be fit for purpose in terms of, you mentioned electric charging points, indeed service stations, and whether they might actually link to third sector, local community groups rather than multinationals. I wonder if you can just maybe explain the kind of wider vision for the road.
Yes, absolutely. So it's certainly my intention that there will be ample opportunity for recharging along the route. And this sits very closely alongside the work that I'm doing in another part of the portfolio on the rollout of EV chargers and our ambitions to go from around the 2,400 mark, although that might not be the right figure, up to 6,000. There is a lot of interest in the availability of service stations and other rest opportunities along the A9, and I absolutely understand that. I know myself, when I'm driving it, you would welcome the opportunity to stop safely, and I think there are also issues for women and other vulnerability issues for being able to do so. The provision of service stations, etc., is not something which is directly the responsibility of Transport Scotland. You know, they are funded to deliver their statutory obligations, and the delivery of service stations is not one of them. However, this is raised with Ms. Hislop and I a lot, and it would certainly be my intention to do what we could to encourage the development of these along the route, because I do acknowledge their importance.
And just a brief follow-up on that. I mean, I think what I would like to see is showcasing Scotland, Perthshire and the Highlands. And for me, that would be not going into a service station that could be located anywhere in Scotland, indeed anywhere in the world. And I think there's some fantastic examples of communities getting involved, community cafes by the roadside in a service station environment. So is there any way that you can make that happen if you share that vision?
Probably not single-handedly, but I can certainly note that alongside the considerable points that are made to Fiona and I about the need for rest opportunities, and I'll do my best to advocate for it.
Thank you.
And just finally, Cabinet Secretary, I noted that in the 2007-11 Parliament, I had been convener of a hybrid committee set up to take forward the Queen's Ferry Crossing project. It identified the route, the difficulties that there were going to be in various villages along planning the process. As was pointed out, that was an Act of Parliament which drove that requirement for parliamentary scrutiny. But it did seem that the cross-party nature of a parliamentary committee looking at agreeing the project which government ministers were then invited to deliver overcame some of the difficulties that there were about, you know, progressing particularly difficult issues. Now, we are where we are in the different processes that are in place. But we have the, and I think we all recognise from the paperwork we've read and everything else, that the Pass of Burnham to Tay, the whole issue around Dunkeld is a particularly difficult one to grapple with. You've talked about there only being one public inquiry so far. Are you building into the kind of thinking in relation to the project that there could yet be difficult areas that have to be resolved, which could lead to a challenge in terms of timing?
Thank you, Convener. Just on your first point, I have been considering myself the best way to make sure that there's strong parliamentary engagement on the next steps. I had looked at what you convened. Did you convene?
Yes,
you did, in respect of the Queensferry crossing. As you say, came from an Act of Parliament, but I would quite like to see, or I will certainly come back to the committee with some views on how we ensure parliamentary engagement. It might not be this committee, although I'll certainly let you know, I would envisage it would probably be net zero or alike. But certainly I will come back when we have more certainty on that. But I definitely want to see Parliament more fulsomely engaged in the next steps. In respect of the Pass of Burnham to the Tay crossing statutory processes, I'll maybe ask officials about timing. The problem is that the timing of these matters are out with our hands, as I'm sure you appreciate. If an inquiry is decided to go ahead, then the length of that is really not something that we can control. Although I hope, again, that because we have had the co-development process, because of the proposed route does take into account a number of the suggestions from the community, that should lessen the likelihood of objections. I can't eliminate it, nor should I, and nor can I control the timing should that go ahead.
Thank you. Mr. Galbury?
Yeah, just to comment on the way the programme has been structured. So the Pass of Burnham to Dunkeld project, which is the only project that still requires to gain ministerial decision. Other projects required to complete other elements of statutory processes, but based on progress so far, we're confident on those. We've looked at the sequencing of work, and the programme that we've outlined means that there's actually considerable float, several years of float, around about the timing of when we would construct Pass of Burnham to Dunkeld. So if it takes longer to complete its statutory processes than we currently anticipate, it can be built in parallel with other work, because it's be sufficiently removed at that time because of prior projects having been completed, so it doesn't present a safety risk, and we have plenty of time to still complete it within the 2035 deadline.
Thank you, Minister, for the comments. On scrutiny, particularly, I think, harking back to the exchange with Mr. Ewing in relation to the capital projects that are potentially going to be vital for development in the north of Scotland. This is really a national infrastructure project which is of importance to the country and to all parties combined. Mr. Chowdhury, just as a very final question you'd like to put.
Yes, sure. Thank you. Just a small question to Cabinet Secretary. Given the time it's taken and missing the dates, etc., are you concerned that the current plan or the current project is going to stick by the time they're giving? Or do you have any concerns?
I think so. A lot has changed in recent times. We have an updated business case. We have 92% of ministerial decisions for statutory processes in hand. We have a new NEC4 contract in use, which was developed in concert with industry. We are utilising a new, or proposing to utilise, or have the option to utilise, a new funding model available to us. And we now have a plan which has very carefully considered the best sequencing and is on about rolling construction to 2035. So there is reason for confidence. Now, I have to caveat that by saying this is a complex project. It's 11 complex projects. Having certainty in an uncertain world is not always easy. But so what I will guarantee, however, is that issues, if they arise, they will arise because that is the nature of major projects. I can guarantee that we will work as quickly as we possibly can to resolve them against our delivery timetable.
Thank you very much. And before I conclude, is there anything further, Cabinet Secretary, you or your colleagues feel we've not touched on that you had come along expecting to reveal to us today?
I was very open-minded, Convener, about what we might cover, so I won't add anything. Just thank you all.
In which case, can I thank you for your engagement and the engagement of your colleagues this morning. Thank you very much, and we'll now suspend briefly. OK, and welcome back to this second meeting of 2024. And our second evidence session this morning, which starts our proceedings under agenda item 3, which is the consideration of continued petitions, is in relation to petition number 1979 to establish an independent inquiry and an independent national whistleblowing officer to investigate concerns about the alleged mishandling of child safeguarding inquiries by public bodies. The petition calls on the Parliament to establish, to urge the Scottish Government to launch an independent inquiry to examine concerns that allegations about child protection, child abuse, safeguarding and children's rights have been mishandled by public bodies, including local authorities and the General Teaching Council. Gaps in the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, which we've discussed, and establish an independent national whistleblowing officer for education and children's services in Scotland to handle these inquiries in the future. This petition has been lodged by Neil McLennan, Christine Scott, Alison Dickey and Bill Cook, and three of whom are with us this morning. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 4th of October, and at that stage we decided we would like to hold a roundtable discussion on the issues raised and to welcome the petitioners if they were available to join us. Unfortunately, Christine Scott is unable to be with us today, but I do welcome Brendan Barnett, who joins in Christine's place. Neil McLellan is a former teacher who's written on the topic of safeguarding gaps. Good morning to you, Mr. McLellan. Alison Dickey is a teacher and a former Edinburgh councillor. As vice convener of the council's Education, Children and Families Committee, she raised concerns of whistleblowers who came to her for support. And Bill Cook is also a former Edinburgh councillor, and the petition submission to the committee describes him as the political lead on the introduction of Edinburgh's new whistleblower system in 2014. So before we begin the kind of discussion involving the issues raised by the petition, I understand that as participants you've prepared brief statements and you would like to share these with the committee today. So is each of you going to be saying something briefly? And have you agreed any order, or will I just... Oh, you've agreed an order. OK, so Mr. Cook is going to kick off. Thank you.
I guess it's within the 3 minutes each. We thank the committee for giving us the opportunity to speak today. My three fellow petitioners are all education professionals. They share decades of experience teaching children. Two have contributed to the development of education policy. Three of us have been elected to public office. And Brendan, who's substituting today, was a senior criminal justice social worker. We all share serious concerns about the alleged failure of public institutions to properly investigate allegations related to safeguarding. In bringing our concerns today, we don't want to take away at all from the amazing work of individuals right across Scotland who each day help protect our children and educate our children. Neither do we want to detract from the good work being done to improve safeguarding. What we're concerned about is when things go wrong, and when it does, what recourse is there to the ordinary citizen? Committee members will be aware that support and submissions include distressing and deeply worrying disclosures. One parent refers to illegality and maladministration. Another parent refers to a culture of coercive control. Yet another refers to significant negligence and incompetence. Another parent laments we have nowhere to go. There are also worrying misapprehensions evident in the institutional responses to the petition. Some appear not to even recognise or acknowledge failings. We'd be happy to expand on that in the discussion. The root of a victim or whistleblower's plight is the power imbalance that exists between themselves, the individuals, institution or public body they find themselves at odds with or exploited by. This is a systemic imbalance. A raid against the lone victim or whistleblower are huge obstacles. A public body's lack of openness and transparency, accompanied by essentially unlimited legal and financial resources to defend against allegations. I'll conclude now with the Children's Commissioner's response to our petition. The Commissioner observed that international human rights law states that children are entitled to higher standards of protection, and that there is a clear positive obligation on the state to ensure that child protection, safeguarding whistleblowing investigations are sufficiently thorough, independent and robust. This is a standard to which our country should aspire. Thank you.
Thank you. Alison Dickey. Good morning.
Convener. I was Edinburgh's Vice Convener of Education, Children and Families for about 5 years. Over that time and beyond, many whistleblowers came to me in desperation, not all related to child protection. Some are supported for a long time, others simply shared allegations. I raised in appropriate ways, some answers and findings reassured, others gave rise to more questions and common concerns emerged. It's difficult to communicate these sensitive matters in a public setting, but it's important to help members understand why action is needed. What follows is a high-level summary of past and present allegations. Serious and organised child abuse in Edinburgh and beyond, supported by public funds and named professionals, covering up a pattern of behaviour amongst male teachers which related to physical abuse. Social workers withholding information from records and placing children at significant risk of physical, sexual and emotional abuse. Questionable NDAs and timing of civil settlements for abuse victims. Children wearing layers of clothing to meet social workers and not all perpetrators of abuse and care held accountable. Public body interference in investigations and potential perverting the course of justice. Years in foster care without permanency assessment. Inaccurate reports. Cover-ups about mishandled child protection in schools. Misuse of public money by a deceased officer and serial abuser. Mismanagement of sex offenders back into the community. Safeguarding gaps in SWIFT's system and access to children's records. Viewing neurodivergent families through an inappropriate child protection lens, resulting in the unlawful removal of children who are thus made even more vulnerable, and allegations of abuse and care follow. I worked with others across parties to raise concerns, but it was the bravery of the Sean Bell whistleblower that led to the Tanner Inquiry and Whistleblowing Review, and the opportunity to more widely raise in air some of these allegations. However, narrow terms of terms and references restricted the much-needed investigation, and whistleblowers believed it to be a whitewash. I resigned from my party in brief in January 22, mainly because I needed to speak and vote more freely. I was concerned at the lack of robust scrutiny on child protection matters and the over-reliance on officer information, fantastic as many of those officers are, and the findings of a restricted inquiry. To conclude, while some of these allegations are within the past 10 years and may be regarded as historic, the systems and many of the personnel are not. All unresolved allegations impact the level of confidence we can have about ensuring the highest standards of protection for our children. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And are we going to Mr. McClellan or to Mr. Barnett next? Mr. Barnett.
Thank you. It is a sad reflection that after so many child protection scandals where local authorities and other agencies have failed to protect children, such as Rochdale Council and Edinburgh Academy, concerns continue to be raised about the fitness of certain local authorities and police services to fulfil their safeguarding duties. Just as concerning is the failure of regulatory bodies such as the SSSC and the GTCS to properly monitor professional standards and investigate malpractice within local authorities. These are just some of the reasons for today's petition. More specifically, and with regard to local authorities, a number of us have witnessed a major Scottish local authority prioritise the protection of its reputation and the targeting of whistleblowers over the protection of children. It is our view that the Tanner inquiry into the culture of this authority was constrained by the narrowness of its terms of reference. From the outset, concerns were expressed regarding the perceived independence of key players and the inquiry in general. It is of note that the inquiry's recommendations have still not been fully implemented. Since the Tanner inquiry, concerns have continued to be raised about this authority's failure to protect children. Whistleblowers have raised ongoing concerns about the following. The insecure storage of and untraceable access to confidential information regarding vulnerable children. The erratic risk management planning for the release of sex offenders into the community. the failure of criminal justice social work managers to ensure social workers complete key duties in relation to risk management and child protection, and ensure that all relevant information is gathered and shared with partner agencies. The failure to hold managers in the Children and Families Department to account in relation to who protected and or supported perpetrators. Some of these individuals have been allowed to leave their posts without being held to account for their actions and their roles in possible cover-ups. These concerns are compounded by other Scotland-wide failings. For example, the fact that parents have no established referral pathway when raising concerns, that is, they are not covered by the Public Interest Disclosure Act. The failure of regulatory bodies to investigate serious concerns raised by parents and whistleblowers. The lack of transparency and accountability in regulatory bodies such as the SSSC. The opaque nature of the relationships between local authorities and regulatory bodies. To conclude, there's an illusion of protection for whistleblowers under the Public Interest Disclosure Act and by qualified and debatable support from organisations such as Safecall. The reality for whistleblowers is that they are targeted, victimised and harassed by their employers. This has a severe impact on their physical, mental and financial well-being. Their isolation is compounded and children put at risk by the fact that there is no independent body whistleblowers can turn to for advice or support. Many of the whistleblowers supporting this petition have found uncomfortable parallels with the post office scandal. Whistleblowers' concerns have been ignored by senior local authority managers, the Tanner Inquiry, elected representatives, regulatory bodies, Scottish Government departments, and their own trade unions. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, and thank you to the clerks for facilitating online access. If I can start with some background, in early 2021, I wrote an article on the difficulties facing those raising issues in education on topics such as the curriculum and national bodies. As a consequence of this article, people contacted me with their own concerns. A common theme emerged of children, especially the most vulnerable, being poorly treated and not safeguarded, and when issues were raised, mishandling occurring. These cases, alongside my professional experience and my knowledge as a former council education officer, highlighted a policy gap in safeguarding children. I alerted the GPCS to my concerns, and the Children's Commissioner and the Scottish Government later highlighted the gap to the GPCS. To date, this gap remains. The gap is quite simple, that local authorities can and do mishandle child protection and safeguarding reports. And the GPCS will not look at reports unless the employer refers them to the GPCS. I engaged in further research. 15 technical FOI questions showed that over a three-year period, GPCS filtered out 196 referrals made to them regarding teacher conduct. These referrals were never investigated at all by the GPCS. Further research shows the referrers got a response, and still do get a response from the GPCS, no matter the severity of the referral or the evidence accompanying, the referral is frivolous, but it is not first referred to the employer, who is most often the local authority. The GPCS told government officials in responses to parliamentary questions they would look to change the word frivolous in the next policy review. The term is still used despite a recent policy review. Additionally, it should be noted the GPCS do and have changed FOI responses on the FOI log and have done so without informing the public of the changes or specifics, nor the initial FOI requester. The GPCS refused to tell a member of the Scottish Parliament, Willie Rennie, the number of the 196 cases that were child protection and safeguarding related. That was in the Parliament in 2012. Further research, again by FOI, reveals that 47 of the 196 referrals were safeguarding and child protection related. GPCS claimed they were aware of these or sorry, police were aware of these, and when the police were not aware of these, the GCCS alert the police to that. The follow-up question asks how many the police were alerted to, and the answer is that one was passed to the police by GCCS. I have heard and we've seen the obstacles that professionals, parents and the public have in raising evidence concerns in good faith. This includes senior officials and a Scottish local authority threatening a university to say they would consider withdrawing public funds because of FOI questions relating to child protection policy. This exemplifies how serious issues can be dealt with by the public bodies. Those asking scrutiny questions face intimidation and corruption using public funds. Employees face their careers, their reputations being crushed by managerial and the financial power of the large organisations. And parents and the public are gaslit, dismissed and are also intimidated. The policy gap evidence undoubtedly has implications with respect of protecting children. This, coupled with the inherent challenges this committee have already recognised whistleblowers face, presents a real and ongoing risk to the protection of children in Scotland. I'm happy to expand on these points in the roundtable discussion, and I thank the committee for the opportunity to share further information.
Thank you, Mr. McLennan. Your sound improved sort of two-thirds of the way through, but I think I certainly, concentrating hard, was able to hear the early part of that as well. Your four statements, thank you very much for those. They've taken up quite a bit of the time that we have available this morning, I should say. And they have also detailed in the content, which is now obviously in the record for us to study, some of the areas I think we might have wished to explore. So coming back, and I think you started, Alison Dickey, and I think I heard some from Neil McLennan as well. Really, without going into the details that may lead to the identification of individuals, and you went through a whole series of examples of concerns where you have identified mishandling of child safeguarding issues. Are there any that you could just illustrate a little bit more comprehensively without necessarily betraying any confidences?
It's very difficult to do so in a public setting. We had originally thought this was going to be private and raised some concerns about that. So what we tried to do was to give you a top level, to give you an idea of the kind of the range and the scope of allegations that are still unresolved, you know, for whistleblowers and for, you know, people at the heart of those cases. And that was the purpose of it, to show you the seriousness of these unresolved matters, because I don't think that's come through to you yet. We can explore some of the processes, if you like, in terms of, you know, it feels often that who is actually investigating. You know, we eventually got to an inquiry with, you know, it's Scotland-wide, these concerns. But if you take Edinburgh as an example, we eventually got to an inquiry where all these concerns might have been, you know, really in-depth investigated to help resolve. But the terms and reference were restricted and that didn't happen. So whistleblowers and, you know, people at the heart of some of these cases feel as if they're punted from left, right and centre and nothing ever happens, and their cases aren't resolved, and someone will say it's somebody else's responsibility or it's this other's responsibility, and it's really hard to not go into the details of a case. I don't want to go any more into detail on that, but there is a bit of a cases all around the place never getting properly investigated and thoroughly investigated, independently investigated.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Cook.
Excuse me. Again, we are constrained, you know, so but much of this particular case I have in mind is in the public domain in any case. A young person made an allegation some years ago, 2006, right? That person was ignored. Right? There was no further investigation at that point. Some years later,
that person was contacted because another person had been subject to abuse. Right? And there was a police inquiry at that point. Ultimately, the individual, the predator, was imprisoned in 2006. In 2017, there was a serious case review, and that identified that that particular individual could have been identified 20 years earlier. Right? But the case review said that there should be a further investigation because other things came out, you know, during the course of that review. Chief Executive at the time instructed a further investigation. That investigation didn't take place, and this is 2017. In 2020, there was another whistleblowing disclosure, and then the situation was revisited. At that point, they found that some of the allegations that had been identified, some of the issues that had been identified 3-4 years earlier, were still, you know, present. So it's just in the way of illustrating that these things take a long while, right? And in this particular example, no action was taken, even though problems had been identified, and that's fairly recent.
And that goes to illustrating the point that I think you were making, Alison Dickey, about a lack of direction. Mm-hmm. Yeah. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to all petitioners. Why would the petitioners like to see an inquiry set up before the conclusion of the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry?
I think there's perhaps a misapprehension. Right? That we are suggesting there should be a whistleblowing system put in place. We believe that there's gaps in the present inquiry in terms of what that's looking at, and we can discuss that further. But in terms of the unresolved issues, what we're simply saying is that we believe that there should be investigations and inquiries into these matters. We're not calling for a public inquiry to be set up. We just feel that there's certain things out there that need to be investigated thoroughly.
Anybody else like to expand on it?
I think I'll just come in there to say that, so you can get a sense of, there is not just issues in Edinburgh, there's issues across the Scotland, and these are unresolved issues. And the point we've tried to make from the outset is that to be have confidence in current child protection, you can't have all those issues sitting out there unresolved. They need to have a thorough investigation. So it is, in terms of an inquiry and investigation, it's a distinct investigation of any of those unresolved cases. And we're not judging that. We are just literally saying those should be investigated so that you can say lessons learned, but you can't learn lessons unless you actually know what the actual, conclusion of a case is. So that would be, we have never from the outset suggested that that should be adding to Sky and to the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, because we would not want to lengthen anything for, you know, children in care in any way. What we're saying is to address the gaps distinctly. And, we've talked already about issues that are getting raised in education, you know, issues that are raised in children's regulated activities. There are gaps, and these gaps need to be addressed. And especially, you know, we're just about to implement children's rights, and it's clear that they should have the highest level of protection. And it shouldn't be a defensive culture. That's what has been felt so out. There's a new campaign, I think, started today or yesterday, and it's called What If You're Right? But that doesn't feel like that's the culture across Scotland. And so it's to really just build on that. We're asking for robust, you know, more robust scrutiny. So the investigation and the National Whistleblowing Officer for Children's, you know, for Children's Service, Education Children's Services.
Mr. McLennan, if you would like to contribute at any time, if you just raise a hand, the clerks can see and they'll let me know that you're trying to come in. Is there anything you'd like to say at this point? Then please do carry on, that's fine.
Thank you, Tommy. Yeah, just to blend the two questions, can be the own question again. This is in the public domain. Christine Graham, MSP, raised very serious concerns, very passionately, about issues that had happened in Scottish Borders Council, which were obviously investigated by Andrew Webster, QC. Now, that is a single case. However, we're seeing replications of those cases in other areas. I mean, some of the areas are very clear, though, that Scottish local authorities have a challenge for them investigating very serious matters where there's a potential conflict of issue of interest. There may be capacity issues, there may be expertise and skill issues in investigation. So NHS obviously have recognised that and put forward an independent national whistleblowing officer, and that's why we believe there should be one across the education and children services area as well. With regards to Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, to Mr. Florence's question, again, there is a specific focus on that which wouldn't capture the range of other allegations that are unresolved just now. There are cases, and as we said before, the vast majority of people have done very, very well in education, but sadly, when it goes wrong, it can go terribly wrong. So there are cases within education and children's services. We've seen an MSP raise concerns about very serious allegations involving youth football in the past, which clearly may not be covered by the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry as it currently stands. Religious bodies may not necessarily be covered. So that gap needs to be closed. But as Alison rightly says, before we start putting together any changes, systemic changes to how we protect our children, we need to thoroughly and properly investigate unresolved allegations so we fully understand where things have gone wrong so that we can then put it right in the future. And I think that's very important, that the unresolved allegations, historic and present, require that robust, independent scrutiny. And the current system perhaps doesn't allow that independent scrutiny.
Procedures are already currently there, statutory duties and national child protection guidance. What concerns do petitioners have about them?
Mr. Cook, I'm saying your name so that the official record know who it is that's actually contributing.
I did have some... somewhere. Give me 1 second, please. Yeah. The problem with the national guidelines is that they're non-statutory, right? And that issue was actually identified, that phenomenon of people not adhering to the guidelines was actually identified in the government's own Child Protection Improvement Plan. There's a direct reference to the issue with and reliance on guidelines. Right, it's a recognised thing that sometimes the guidelines might not be followed, and that's the problem. It's we can commend the guidelines, excellent. There's a lot of good work in the guidelines, an awful lot of good stuff. But what happens when the guidelines aren't actually implemented? And the reference has been made to the Tanner Inquiry. The Tanner Inquiry stated something to the effect that within Edinburgh, it wasn't a safe culture for whistleblowing and that problems did exist. And that's despite the fact that there's national guidelines. So there's plenty of evidence out there that sometimes guidelines are guidelines, they might not be implemented.
Mr. McLennan.
Thank you. Just a couple of points to add on to that. First of all, absolutely that case that they are guidelines, they're not statutory requirements, and that presents a challenge. Various concerns have been raised about the guidelines. There's lots of good in the guidelines. However, I always think a policy should be something that a practitioner can lift and can be very easily used. But it has been described variously as contradictory and confusing. There's a range of issues with them. I mean, for example, it has been highlighted to the Scottish Government that the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service appear more regularly in the National Child Protection Guidelines than the General Teaching Council appears in it, which appears an odd, that's just one example. But there are lots of areas of concern with them. The Children's Commissioner, who are the national expert body for safeguarding of children and children's rights, have raised a range of issues with the government about the Child Protection Guidelines. And to my knowledge, that not all of that has been progressed in policy reviews. What I think is linking back to Alison's point is really important here. We could go back to look at the Child Protection Guidelines and re-tinker and re-amend them But to go back to Alison's point, until we've conducted a thorough independent inquiry into unresolved historic and present allegations, there's little point in going and moving guidelines without that detailed knowledge of what's gone wrong in the cases that have gone before. The Andrew Webster QC inquiries out there, it clearly details breakdowns throughout the process of a child protection issue being raised. And there are multiple other examples of that across the country. So until they can be tabled, there's little point in trying to manoeuvre things to try and cover cracks. It needs that belt and braces review, in my opinion.
Thank you. David Thomas? Mr. Barnett.
Just in respect of guidelines, obviously I'm coming out from a criminal justice perspective. There are national guidelines, MAPA guidelines and local authority guidelines with regards to the risk management of high-risk sex and violent offenders. So local authorities have guidance for their social workers, and there are national guidelines through the multi-agency public protection arrangements. I used to chair case conferences very similar to this in the setup here, and I would have a social worker before me and I would be saying, can you tell me, we've got a serious sex offender who's due for release, what are the plans, what are his risks, how are we going to cover those risks, you know, do we need to make any arrangements, where are the victims, where are we going to house him, etc, etc. And what was really disturbing was the way that the national guidelines and local guidelines regarding risk management, which was just about due diligence and having an investigatory approach to information, was not followed. I'll just draw a parallel. I was watching the Grenfell disaster inquiry, and what struck me was the number of times agencies said, well, we always assumed the other agency had shown due diligence. Therefore, we didn't have to, because we trusted the other agency. And what I found doing my job was regularly social workers would be going, well, we trust the prison's assessment. We trust children and families' assessment. And they haven't done their own assessment. And each agency would be there saying the same about the other. And there was this kind of failure to follow national guidelines and local guidelines. And then when I took this to local authority, and then to the SSSC, the SSSC refused to investigate. And it's just astounding, the risky behaviour that's going on. So I just wish to make the point about national guidelines.
Okay, Alison Dickey.
Just to add to this, sorry, before I think David's want to speak. You asked about the National Protection Guidance, which obviously has just not long been updated as well. My experience has been, and I've always believed, that child protection is actually a constant improvement journey, and that's exactly what the Scottish Government has recognised and is promoting out there. That's not been the experience. The experience continues to be it's defensive. Everything's in place. You know, everything's all fine. Going back to your original point in terms of some of those issues, and I'm trying not to get into cases as I say, but some of the issues are sharing information. You know, agencies sharing information between them. And in one particular case that I can think of, I don't think key information was shared. You know, in that would have absolutely helped that situation. And I know that's been addressed a wee bit sometime in forward improvements. You've got that lack of scrutiny. So in the busy life of members and the busy life of councillors, you know, unless you're actually listening to your whistleblowers, I could have said, I don't want to listen to you. You come at a different perspective when you're actually scrutinising officers' reports because you're more informed. Another one is I've sat in multi-agency groups in public protection and it feels that there's not much discussion, you know, when you come to those forums, and there's probably been lots of discussion before that, but I would have liked to see more questions and scrutiny of those in those environments. The other one is that it's too historic. You know, we're not resourcing historic. Wouldn't you rather be focused on the current? And to me, that misses an absolute point that the past is connected to current child protection. Another one is that information is too limited to identify any criminality, and some of it to me is quite stark. And then directed back again to either the public body or the social work, which is the source of the allegation, and of course the whistleblowers not wanting to go there. And of course we had the safe call system, but of course the inquiries, you know, highlighted the flaws within that. So you can see there's a lot of different things that jar and lead to people shouting in all sorts of corners all over Scotland, please listen to us and let's all together work better to, you know, more robust scrutiny.
I want to just move along because I'm conscious of our time. Mr. Golden.
Thanks, convener. You've mentioned you're not adhering to guidelines, and I'm particularly interested in local authority perspective. Do you think this is a result of resource constraints or a culture or both? And also, do you have an assessment of how local authorities are adhering to guidance across Scotland? Is there examples of best practice, worst practice, or is it a similar picture, or do you even have that information?
Thank you. I can't speak Scotland-wide. In my post in a major local authority in Scotland, I would have access to reports from all over Scotland, say offenders moving to my city, for instance. So I would ask for that information. And you would find the same erratic compilation of information. And so my job was to say, what are the gaps in the information? Please, can you go and find it? I think the thing about time is, I think I'll have to say this. I think with regards risk management of with relation to information, the probation service in England has a much better system. For instance, the tragedy of the two teenage killers in Warrington this week, all that information regarding them, all the assessments, the psychological assessments, will be sent to the probation service, and they will have a full file of that information. That isn't so. In 20 years' time, when somebody's making a risk assessment as to how and when those individuals might be released, they will have a huge amount of information. That doesn't happen in Scotland. They will get a court report. And in 20 years' time, somebody maybe in my position will be saying, well, where's all that other information? It was huge. In Scotland, I've often had to refer to press reports to get the details of offences, because the Procurator Fiscal's Office does not send files of information out. It's too costly. What we will get is the odd report. We will then have to go seeking reports and asking the police for information. But it's not a system. It's not a comprehensive system. So there's some excellent work within every authority, I'm sure, but also there's some dreadful work. And so,
thanks.
Thank you,
Alison.
I just may add, very briefly, to that. So, without a doubt, resources are an issue. It's an issue in social work, children's services, it's an issue in education, and of course that's an issue. We also know culture is an issue because the Tannan Inquiry, in particular, pulled that out. But also, we're asking dig deeper too, because let's not be naive about what's out there, and our children just need the deepest of investigations. And I think in that nutshell I gave you, you can see why I can't say everything's okay.
That's fine.
Mr. Ewing, I noticed you were kind of following that particular exchange with interest. Would you like to comment?
I did think that the comments Mr. Barnett made were apposite, and we perhaps could learn from the English experience there, the example quoted. I just wanted to ask about the establishment of an independent national whistleblowing officer. And firstly, I mean, how would this help address these concerns? Would this be a new public body, or could the functions be
made more explicit, perhaps, as part of the Young Person and Children's Commissioner.
Yep. Mr. Cook?
I think the last point there, that might be a way forward. Right? I certainly think that. I think the thing about whistleblowing and public inquiries, if I can address that point, what we see is public inquiries taking place 10 years, 20 years, 30 years after the events. Right? What we need is for some intervention that can change things at the time and give support and perhaps be the champion of the whistleblower or the person that's been victimised. I hope that answers the point.
That makes a lot of sense, actually, yes. And I mean, I'm attracted by the idea that it would be part of the Children's Commissioner's functions and made more explicit, perhaps even if on a statutory basis, because that would avoid having to create a new public body. But can I ask, I mean, if this happens, let's assume this happens, and that might help things be done more quickly rather than, you know, the Edinburgh Academy case where we're looking at events that happened decades ago, I believe. You know, what happens if the Children's Commissioner or whistleblower officer says, well, this should happen, and then the local authorities or whoever it is says, well, we don't agree? You know, what happens then? Where does it go from there? Does it go to ministers? Does it go to press? Given that these may be sensitive matters, how would a dispute between the whistleblowing officer and the relevant public authority be handled or resolved?
I think that's an excellent point. I'm not sure I have the answer to that.
I think there's a role for the professional regulatory bodies there. I think, you know, my problem has been I have raised issues about, I raised it within my employers. I didn't want to draw my employers into disrepute. I wanted to say, we've got a problem here, it's a risk to the public. And what I was actually told, can you imagine if I told you not to ask so many questions? Which is what my manager told me. And my job is risk management. Don't ask so many questions. So I then raised that with the SSSC, and they would not. I'm saying there's problems, they're not following the risk management guidelines. It's a professional issue. You need to address this. And the SSSC would not address this. So it's not only an issue with the local authority, it's about the professional standards of the individuals within those authorities.
And I think Mr. McLennan would like to come in as well. Right. Mr. McLennan?
Two very sound points, Mr. Ewan, and I think to pick up on both of them. We're talking about checks and balances here, obviously, and local authorities marking their own homework, and the very serious issue of child protection is a major risk. Obviously, we see within the police service, for example, you know, they would have another force investigate them, although, of course, even that's been questioned, you know, police investigating police, even though it's different forces, so does it need to be independent? NHS have clearly grappled with this and put in an independent national whistleblowing officer, which avoids the issue where local authorities, I've outlined the concerns about local authorities, GCCS clearly stated to the Parliament that they weren't in the front line of child protection. They've got a specific role of legislation on regulation, and on registration, which is separate. So the INWO, I think, gives that sort of umbrella assurance and stops some of the cracks in the system. Now, I hear very much the attraction of going down, adding responsibilities to the Children's Commissioner, and that was something that the Parliament may wish to discuss. A couple of points I've raised with that with regards to your second point. Firstly, the commissioners have a very specific locus, and that may detract from the locus they've got, that perhaps the INWO needs to be separate. And the second point I'd raise, I think, really hits on the point you made there. One of the challenges the Children's Commissioner has just now is in legislation, it states in one part of the legislation they can instruct a public body, they can make a recommendation or they can report to a public body to do something. The very next piece of legislation then says the public body can simply write back to the Children's Commissioner and see why they're not doing it. So they're ultimately given teeth and the teeth are taken away. So when we do hopefully come to setting up an INW or Independent National Whistleblower, which are very much so cross-party, people see that it's been needed in NHS and therefore we highlighted gaps in education and children's services, that the legislation will be framed in such a way that that is put in place, that there is the ability to progress things rather than being hamstrung by the legislation, because that particular part of the Children's Commissioner legislation really hamstrings them. There are examples where the Commissioner has written to public bodies and they have simply ignored, because the legislation allows them to ignore the recommendations of the body to have oversight of safeguarding of children in Scotland.
Mr. Hugh, I'm conscious we're into our last 5 or 6 minutes.
Well, I mean, I am very concerned about the general issue of public bodies marking their own homework. And when any complaint, whether it's a staff complaint, a complaint about management, is dealt with, there is a tendency to circle the wagons and nothing very much ever happens. So I think that concern is real, and I think the answers have been very helpful. But can I just kind of postulate that one solution might be to resolve the question of what happens if the whistleblower says, well, you should do this, or this is my recommendation, and then it's ignored. I mean, could there be, depending upon the nature of the issue, if it's a criminal matter, a reference, for example, to a children's panel? And if it were not a criminal matter, and therefore out with the remit of the children's panel, could there be a procedure to refer a matter to the Scottish Government, to children's minister? And that, albeit not a perfect remedy or disposal, would at least provide a route. And I'm just thinking out loud here, so I've got no expertise in this area at all, but would either of those or other possibilities be something that you might want to consider and come back to us on, given the time constraints?
Yes, I think the helpful thing there, if you would like to reflect on that and maybe the earlier answer, because we'd be very happy to receive any further submission, given that there was a certain uncertainty beforehand. But I'm very keen, because Mr. Chowdhury would like to come in as well, so I just want to give him that opportunity. Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you very much. Good morning, panel. Just want to ask, I want to stay with the same point as my colleague, Mr. Ewing, has been asking. Just a clarification. How do you think the National Whistleblowing Officer would bridge the gap in current safeguarding provision? It's just, I know quite a lot of answers have been given, but how do you think could bridge the gap?
Mr. Cook.
Yeah. I think one of the advantages in having a system like that is it raises the standard. I mean, reference was made to people, the circles, the wagons circling earlier on. I think to have an independent body adds another element to how authorities or institutions might operate. The fact that they might be subject to independent scrutiny. And if a whistleblowing system officer had the investigative powers and the links that have been alluded to, that might change behaviours, and I think that's part of this.
Mr. Barnett.
I would think the office would also act as a focal point for people who have raised concerns about unsafe practice. All of us have, I think everyone, all the whistleblowers that I've ever met, have all been isolated, and we've all roamed around, and we've all I've gone down this pathway to try and address the issues, and there's no actual guidance for anyone or support. I keep making reference to other issues, but in the same way as the post office workers formed their own group, and through that they were able to move forward. Whistleblowers can't do that. They're all very isolated. They don't know who else is a whistleblower. So I think by establishing an office, it would then enable to give guidance and support and procedure as to how to investigate serious issues.
Alison Dickey.
Yeah, just to tidy up, it's just going also to go back to Mr. Ewing's question as well. So it's that gap, it's that marking your own homework, it's that independence. But going back to Mr. Ewing as well, and that children and young people, you know, the Children's Commissioner, and and the way ahead in terms of how many people out there are unresolved. There's lots of different issues. That's a huge resource issue. So I think if, you know, the Children's Commissioner, ideal, but, you know, we'd need much, much more resourcing to be able to take something like that forward. And the legislation to actually direct, you know, public bodies to act in support. And the final point would be, even if we're putting it back to the Scottish Government, people could say that's the government marking their own homework too. So it's thinking about all those things and finding a very independent route that just targets those gaps and makes sure we mop up all of these unresolved concerns.
Thank you. We've packed quite a lot of information into this last hour, which I'll want to have some time to reflect on when we see it. Some of the issues that have cropped up have maybe also prompted thoughts in your own mind of additional information you might like to contribute to us. We'd be very happy to receive that in advance of our next consideration of the petition. It's a fairly packed agenda again this morning. I'm sure we could probably have packed more information into an even further and extended discussion. But can I thank all four of you very much for taking the time to join us here in Parliament this morning. We'll obviously be keeping the petition open and we'll have an opportunity to reflect on the evidence we've heard and decide on next steps. And we look forward to hearing from you further as appropriate. Thank you all very much. And I suspend briefly before we move to the next item. Thank you. And we're back. And the next of our continued petitions is petition number 1930 to ensure customers are always given information on the cheapest possible fare in the new ScotRail contract. This has been lodged by George Ecton and calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that a requirement of future rail contracts is for customers to be given information on the cheapest possible fare as a matter of course and recognise the vital role of the existing ticket office estate in delivering on this aim. Last considered this quite some time ago, the 17th of May 2023. At that point, we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and to ScotRail. The response from ScotRail notes that while it has no current plans to upgrade the retail infrastructure support the use of bank cards for tap on or tap off rail journeys, which is how you get around the London Underground in various places, it is actively pursuing a pilot scheme for a mobile phone app to achieve a similar outcome, which is actually the modern way of getting around the London Underground, I think, as long as you've got a signal. Transport Scotland responded to tell us that it anticipated the National Smart Ticketing Advisory Board to be operational by the end of 2023. And I understand from the clerks that the board commenced operation in November. The Scottish Government have also confirmed it has no plans to remove paper rail tickets, noting that paper tickets now include a QR code that can be scanned to validate the ticket. The response also makes reference to much anticipated fare fares review, which has been expected by the end of 23, but is not as yet to be published. Members may be aware that the Minister for Transport indicated on the 18th of January that the review would likely be published at the beginning of this month. We've also received two submissions from the petitioner sharing his disappointment at the lack of either detail or urgency in addressing the issues raised by the petition. Mr. Ecton also wanted to draw our attention to the recent research which found that train station ticket machines can charge more than double the price of booking the ticket online. It's worth noting that this research did not include stations located in Scotland, which will come as a relief to me, certainly. Do members have any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider and keep the petition open and write to the Minister for Transport once a Fair Affairs Review has been published to seek details on any recommendations related to the asks of the petition.
I think that's a very obvious course now, given that that statement is imminent. Are members content? We are. Petition number 1945 to ban the extraction and use of peat for horticulture and all growing media by 2023. This was lodged by Elizabeth Otway and calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to place a legal ban on the extraction of peat, peat imports, exports and sales in order to protect peatlands both in Scotland and worldwide. We last considered this on the 3rd of May last year. The Scottish Government has since published its analysis of responses to its consultation on ending the sale of peat in Scotland. An extract of the analysis is available in today's papers, and it concludes that among individual hobby gardeners, there is broad support for introducing a ban on the sale of peat in Scotland. Among organisations, however, support was more limited and several negative impacts were anticipated. The most common year suggested for introducing a ban on the sale of peat for retail horticultural was 2023, with organisations preferring a later date of 28 to 2030. On the use of peat for cultural purposes, the Scottish Government's written response to the committee states that it is mindful of the needs of crofters and islanders and is working to determine the impact on those groups as a result of ending the sale of peat. The submission states that outcomes from the consultation, stakeholder engagement and impact assessments will form robust evidence that will guide Scottish ministers as to the scope of any sales ban. Do colleagues have any suggestions or comments? Mr. Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider writing to the Scottish Government for an update on whether its delivery plan and timetable for phasing out the sale of horticultural peat will be published, and whether the Government intends to look beyond the sale of peat and consider banning the extraction of peat with an exemption for crofters and traditional and cultural use.
Thank you. Any other suggestions to add to that? Are we content to proceed on that basis? Mr. Ewing? Yes?
Just to emphasise the latter bit that... you know, we interfere with crofters' traditional extraction of peat at our peril.
Yes. No. All types of crofters, humble or otherwise.
Well, there would be civil unrest if the crofters were denied the right to extract peat in their own land. That would be unthinkable, I think, to many of us.
Yeah. OK, thank you. We are agreed on that course of action. That brings us to petition number 1946, to call on the Scottish Government to pay all charges for homeless temporary accommodation. And this has been lodged by Sean Anthony Clerken. It calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to use general taxation to pay all charges for homeless temporary accommodation, including writing off the £33.3 million debt owed by homeless people for temporary accommodation to local authorities. We last considered this petition on the 3rd of May last, and in its recent response to the committee, the Scottish Government outlined its planned work on two relevant recommendations from the Temporary Accommodation Task and Finnish Group's report. Recommendation 14 in the report calls for a benchmarking process for temporary accommodation and greater transparency on charges, and the Scottish Government has stated that it will engage with COSLA as necessary on this recommendation. And then recommendation 15 calls for a review of the guidance to local authorities in setting charges for temporary accommodation by clearly defining the terms reasonable charge and affordable. The Housing Affordability Working Group has been developing a shared understanding of housing affordability with a critical review of the main working definitions and the different uses in policy and practice, which could potentially help to clarify the relevant guidance. Now, the petitioner points out that there was a 27% increase in households living in temporary accommodation between March 2020 and March 2023. And he notes that Edinburgh, Glasgow and Argyll and Bute local authorities have declared housing emergencies and calls on the committee to pressurise the Scottish Government to act. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to COSLA to seek its views on the action called for in the petition and to ask for information about its work on Recommendation 14 from the Temporary Accommodation Task and Finnish Group report. In particular, a committee could ask what engagement COSLA had with the Scottish Government so far in relation to its work.
OK. I wonder if we might also write the Scottish Government to ask how it intends to address the concerns about the existing households where they've got a debt arising from temporary accommodation charges which have already been accrued. In particular, the committee, I think, would be interested to know how ongoing household debt from temporary accommodation aligns with the Government's priority to reduce the number of households in temporary accommodation by 2026. Are you content with both those, colleagues, content with both those proposals? Mr. Chowdhury.
Should we ask the councils as well then? Because I think the councils are under pressure as well. with the when we did a roundtable with the local communities and found that
I'm just wondering if we're writing to COSLA, whether we're not potentially accommodating that through COSLA. Yes. Thank you. Petition number 2006, to review and simplify the legislation in relation to dismissal of property factors. And I'm delighted to see that we've been joined by our parliamentary colleague, Sarah Boyack, in relation to this petition. And we'll hear from you in just a moment, Ms. Boyack. The petition is lodged by Ewan Miller, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Property Factors Scotland Act to cover dismissal of property factors or bring forward other regulations that would achieve the same aim. This could include giving the first tier tribunal powers to resolve disputes related to the dismissal of property factors. We last considered this position on the 3rd of May, where we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and other relevant stakeholders at the time, and we received responses from the Minister for Victims and Community Safety, the Property Managers Association Scotland, and the charity Under One Roof, which were set out in the papers which colleagues received ahead of today's meeting. Those responses note the instruments that are already available to homeowners to challenge property factors via the first tier tribunal that I referred to a moment ago and the courts process more widely. Responding then in June, the Minister also committed to providing an update on progress towards the publication of the voluntary code of practice for landowning maintenance companies by early this year. We've also received submissions from the petitioner and Sheila Young highlighting their own experiences of the difficulties and challenges involved in trying to remove their property factors. And I suspect many of us as MSPs have received constituents who've contacted us with individual and specific issues as well, and expressing concern that the gravity of the situation facing homeowners across the country is perhaps not being fully understood. Before I ask members to comment, I'd delighted to hear if Sarah Boyack would like to assist the committee in its consideration.
Yes, I would. Thank you very much, Convener, for the opportunity to address the committee this morning. Issues with factors is an area I am increasingly getting casework from constituents on, and the casework covers a range of issues relating to property factors. The main issue is that factors are seen as unaccountable. So high and rising costs, high quotes for repairs with insufficient information to assess value for money, poor communication, lack of engagement and interest in engagement with residents, historic debts passed to current owners, but very difficult to challenge costs or standards of work, suggest improvements or remove them. Constituents feel powerless against factors that have been appointed by the developer. There's a lack of a clear tendering process for the initial appointment, which the petitioner references by virtue of the fact that the factor was appointed by the developer. And there's a lack of transparent information about services and costs before commitment to buy new build. So people buy a property without knowing exactly what they are committing to financially. And reliance on title deeds is problematic because they're not clear re-voting rights, processes and procedures. So constituents have reported to me poor communication, responding to queries, unwillingness to engage to improve services or processes, errors in invoices and staff unclear about what they should be doing. And there's a big worry over future costs. For example, repair of unadopted roads, rising costs but people's income reducing and no help available if somebody's income falls. And using the codes of practice to challenge factors is seen as incredibly cumbersome and it works against individual owners. And it's a huge amount of organisation that owners have to do to reach out to their neighbours. Then the first tier tribunal is also incredibly daunting for owners, and they may be up against the factors and the legal team. So I've asked written and oral questions on what steps the Scottish Government will make to ensure the system will work for property owners. And last year, the Competition and Markets Authority, in their working paper published in November, referenced the imbalance of power between factors and homeowners. So I think the issues being raised with me by constituents come down to the power of factors and the power of homeowners. And in an earlier consideration of the petition, Mr Ewing made points in defence of factors and their role. And I do want to be clear that I think that having a factor in place is always better than not having a factor in place. Where a factor isn't in place can lead to buildings failing, falling into a state of repair and basic health and safety not being followed. That's not in anyone's interest. but there has to be more transparency from the appointment to the capacity to change a factor. A constituent of mine has calculated how much their factor earns. They pay £45 a quarter in factor management fees, and in their development, there are over 250 properties. So in one development, not that far from this Parliament, one factor is receiving over £11,000 a quarter and nearly £50,000 a year for managing the property. And that doesn't include the cost of the works that need to be done, the owners pay for. So to conclude, Convener, I think Parliament has a duty to ensure our constituents are protected through legislation. I think the Scottish Government have been slow to act, and I would encourage the committee to use this petition to think of ways to ensure that there's a fair power balance between factors and homeowners. And thank you again for the opportunity to address the committee.
Not at all. Thank you very much, Ms Boyack. And I have to say, you touch on issues which as a constituency MSP have been raised by constituents of mine. I suppose I would say that there are good factors and less good factors. There's good practice and there's bad practice. And obviously constituents tend to contact us when they have been faced with an issue. But I think the issues that you raise there and touch upon are ones which are becoming increasingly part of my kind of casework profile. Colleagues, having heard that and reflected, we're still waiting for the Scottish Government's publication. Are any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed? Mr. Torrance.
I wonder if the committee would consider writing to the Minister for Victims and Community Safety, highlighting the petitioner submissions and seeking an update on the work to finalise the publishing the voluntary code of practice for land-owning maintenance companies.
I'm content that we do that. Have any other thoughts as to things we might consider? Mr. Golden?
I think once we receive the response, it might be worthwhile hearing from the Minister on this, because actually the proposal is for a voluntary code of practice, which clearly isn't mandatory for those factors. And I just wonder, again, without seeing the submission, but it might be worthwhile hearing just certainly from the Minister and perhaps other stakeholders on this point.
Yes. Mr. Chowdhury, you agree?
Yeah, I agree. I think as we need
Mr. Ewing, you obviously had concerns last time round, but not in relation to, I think, the petition, but just in case of unforeseen consequences of actions that might be taken.
Well, I was pleased to hear Sarah Boyack say that it's generally speaking beneficial to have a factor rather than to have none, because if you have no factor, then common repairs, whether it's in a tenement or for that matter, an estate where there is substantial common property to be maintained, if that's neglected, it leads to huge problems. So, my experience of factors over 20 years in legal practice was that it's a bit of a thankless task, and the remuneration is generally speaking modest in relation to the amount of work. And the just sheer time spent on speaking to people and so on. So, I've seen mostly good practice, but as I said, members have received complaints, and I have received complaints. I do think many of the problems are not really going to be solved by legal reform, but are more practical difficulties. And at the end of the day, if anyone, as I understand it, Convener, and this may be a bit rusty because it's 20 years since I've practiced, but if anyone overcharges, it charges extortionate fees, and I think, you know, Sarah Boyack was kind of suggesting that the example that she gave illustrated that, then I think there are existing legal remedies to challenge the level of fees where they're grossly exorbitant in relation to the provision of services required. If services are worth, say, £1,000, you cannot charge £1 million for it. You can go to the Sheriff Court, and there is, I believe, a remedy there. So I'm just not convinced, Convener, that we're necessarily going to progress and by means of legislation, but I do support Mr. Torrance's recommendation that we see if there's anything further that the Minister can recommend, and the voluntary code of practice, and see how that's getting on.
Well, shall we write and take that as our first step and then reserve the possibility to pursue it? Because I think I mean, Ms. Boyack was suggesting, and I'm not sure I disagree, that depending on what this code of practice said, there might need to be a little bit more direction to try and make things happen rather than to find we've embraced something which is then just widely ignored, which is the key thing. Are we agreed? We are. Thank you very much. Next, and I think the last of our ongoing petitions is petition number 2008, provide funding for a separate mental health A&E for children, lodged by Kirsty Solomon, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide funding to create a separate A&E for children and young people presenting with mental health issues. Following the previous consideration of this petition, the committee put the points raised by the petitioners, the Scottish Government. The submission outlines a number of work streams, including work with Police Scotland and the Scottish Ambulance Service to improve unscheduled care pathways. The response notes that attendance at a children's hospital instead of general A&E may be advised where this is advisable and appropriate and available. In response to the petitioner's concerns about the efficacy of phone assessments, the submission states that a patient-centred approach is adopted when considering the suitability of digital technology and that this is included in the National Guidance for Clinicians. The Minister's response recognises that the CAMS target of all boards achieving a 90% standard by March 2023 was not achieved, and points to ongoing work with health boards to develop CAMS out of our service provision. The petitioner has responded to the Minister, raising questions about the impact of significant staff cuts on the planned work with Police Scotland and the Scottish Ambulance Service. She's asked how many psychiatric teams there are, as her experience involved waiting for several hours as the team was not based in the hospital. The petitioner shares that many families have reached out to her to say that their child could not get help through the mental health hubs because they were under 12. She asks for clarity on what services are available for children under the age of 12. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Chowdhury.
To the Scottish Government to seek... I've lost it here.
To the Minister maybe for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport.
That's right, yeah. And to ask what was the age people using the services, if there is any. My question was how many people have attempted to accept support through the mental health hubs and those how many were under 12 years of old?
OK, and I think we might like to know just the number of psychiatric teams in Scotland, and it would be useful to have that broken down by Health Board, and whether the Scottish Government recognises that increased training will be required with partner agencies such as Police Scotland and the Scottish Ambulance Service, just to ensure that we improve the unscheduled care pathways, and if this is the fact the case, what resources and funding will need to be put in place. Are we content with those suggestions? Anything else? Nope, that's fine. Thank you very much. We'll keep the petition open and we will investigate further and return to it when we have those responses from the Minister. That brings us to agenda item 4, which is the consideration of new petitions. And as always, to those who might be tuning in to hear their petition being considered for the first time, can I say that we, in advance of that first consideration, go to the Scottish Parliament's Independent Research Service, SPICE, and to the Scottish Government for an initial consideration. And we do that because were we not to, those would be the first two things we would recommend doing, and that would just simply add delay to our consideration. So, petition number 2060, which is to review existing legislation and legal remedies against trespassers, and this has been lodged by Datey Broad. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review and revise existing legislation to offer better protection against trespassers. The SPICE briefing outlines the circumstances in which the public have the right to roam, noting that exceptions to this include domestic houses and gardens. The briefing also notes that many people incorrectly, I was quite surprised by the briefing, I have to say, believe that the law of trespass doesn't exist in Scotland. Police Scotland have highlighted difficulties, though, in applying the law in practice. Notably, the police have no jurisdiction to trespass to land, as it is a civil matter, and they cannot insist on the removal of trespassers. And Police Scotland's comments on trespass state that the best and safest course of action is to obtain a court order, which, if breached, may then turn into a criminal matter. The Scottish Government's response to the petition also outlined information about the current law on trespassing, and in response to the petition's ask regarding responsibility for injuries on the land, the Scottish Government stated that the duty of care is the same regardless of whether or not an individual has permission to be on the occupier's land, but factors such as the foreseeability of unauthorised entry and any steps taken to prevent unauthorised entry and to warn of dangers may be of relevance in determining whether or not reasonable care has been taken in the particular circumstances. The response also notes that the evidential burden to prove trespass would depend on whether the individual was pursuing a criminal or civil law case. And I've got to say, for my own part, having read the briefing, I thought it said little that you could actually risk doing, particularly in the current climate, where it seems to me that your interests are secondary to those of the people who want to trespass on your property. That was basically how it all read to me. Although we pretend otherwise, the reality is that's how it'll be if you seek to do anything. And it's also very difficult because it doesn't define what force was. So if you were to escort somebody off, I imagine force would now include even laying hands upon however gently that was done. So I found the briefing quite dispiriting, really. I don't know, do colleagues have any suggestions of what we might do? Mr. Torrance?
I wonder if a committee would consider keeping the petition open and write to the Scottish Government to ask whether it intends to carry out work related to issues raised in the petition and whether it will undertake work to raise awareness about public rights to access different types of land and the law of trespass in Scotland.
And I would like to ask the Scottish Government whether they think the current law of trespass in Scotland is worth the paper it's written on. And I say that in all seriousness because I wasn't really quite sure what your remedy was under it. Petitioner, so we'll keep that petition open, and I can say to our petitioner that the briefing and seems to recognise some of the issues you've raised. Petition number 2062 to introduce a national screening programme for prostate cancer. This has been lodged by Bill Alexander. It clearly has a topical flair to it, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce a national screening programme for prostate cancer. The SPICE briefing states that there is no one test used to diagnose prostate cancer. The most common tests include a prostate-specific antigen, a PSA, which is a blood test, a physical examination of the prostate, and a biopsy. The briefing points out that PSA blood tests can sometimes miss cancer in some patients and can just as easily falsely diagnose others. A heightened PSA is not the same thing as prostate cancer. However, advancements in MRI technology and biopsy techniques could facilitate the development of a national screening programme. The Scottish Government response notes that the UK National Screening Committee considered whether to recommend population screening in November 2020 and frankly concluded this could not happen based on the available evidence. It will review this recommendation, however, in the next 12 months. The response highlights that a large prostate screening study called Transform, that's a large prostate screening study rather than a study of large prostates. I'm assuming it's that way round, called Transform, which will look at potential innovative screening methods with hundreds of thousands of men due to be recruited for the study. And I comment on all of this as somebody who has had a heightened PSA, an MRA, eye and blood and biopsy myself for these very matters at hand. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance?
Given the evidence before the committee, I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the evidence currently available, the UK National Screening Committee concluded that it would not recommend a prostate screening programme, but considering they will review this in 12 months' time, I wonder if the petitioner would consider, if he was not happy with their review, bring the petition back.
What does that mean?
When the UK National Screening Committee are going to...
We're writing to them to find out what they're doing, are we?
No, I was considering closing it, because they're going to review their decision in 12 months' time, aren't they?
Well, I think that 12 months' time was... when was that received? Do we know? Sorry? November. Yeah, OK. So, in fact, we could potentially have to wait till November this year before we... Mr. Ewing?
I certainly can see Mr. Torrance's argument, because the reply we've got is quite complete in the sense that, as I read the response from the Scottish Government, it says, well, there are no real ways in which a definitive test can be issued at the moment. That's the challenge. It's not that there's not a desire, perhaps, to have a test, if a test worked, but a test doesn't work. But my reading of it is that the UKNSC are due to review the recommendation in the next 12 months. That sounds to me as if the review is to start in 12 months, and it might take quite a lot longer. I mean, I wonder if it would be any harm in the meantime in perhaps signifying our general concern and interest, because it's such a widespread cancer, by possibly writing, not closing it at this stage. It may be that we would close it after further response, but to write to the UK National Screening Committee to ask if we consider the findings of the Transform study, how frequently its decision to not recommend population screening will be reviewed, how it decides the frequency with which to review recommendations. And just to sort of stress the urgency here, because there are so many men that will be affected by this in their lifetime, 8 out of 10, I think I read somewhere, which is an incredibly high proportion. Well, and the screening tests available for so many conditions and diseases have been one of the tremendous advances in society over the past 20 years that have saved lives in so many cases. So the lack of a valid method in prostate does seem to be something that is a matter of real urgency. So,
would you be content for us to...
I will go with Mr. Hughes' recommendation.
Very grateful. Are we content to pursue it on that basis? We are, thank you. That takes us to the end this morning of our public business, and therefore I look forward to welcoming those who follow our proceedings back at our next meeting. Thank you. Now...